What happens when you've been doing something for thousands and thousands of years and then someone comes along and says, let's turn it upside down? It's exactly what Cheryl Dunn is doing at Semantics. I got to speak to a pioneer today and we talked about data-centric accounting as opposed to debits and credits and all the other stuff that we've been used to for you know, years and years and years. So she tried to explain it to me. It's a little bit difficult, but it's quite incredible what is available and how people are doing things differently. So if you want a different perspective on debits and credits and how data-centric accounting can change how we're doing things, then listen into this episode. And without any further hesitation, here we go. Over to Cheryl.
Good afternoon or good morning if you're in Michigan. Hello, Cheryl.
Hello, Ashley.
So thank you very much for joining me at the dawning of the day. What sort of time is it in Michigan today? That's Michigan, US, yeah?
Yes, it's 7:30 in the morning where I am.
Oh, that's not a bad time, is it?
No, not a bad time at all.
Oh, fantastic. Paint a picture of where you live, because I live in Devon, but what does Michigan look like?
Michigan is a mix of farmland and woods and water. Lots of lakes in Michigan.
Okay. Yep.
And I actually live on 26 acres with woods and a field and a pond, and it's very beautiful here.
Hang on, you live in a park.
Yes, I live in a park.
That sounds absolutely fantastic. Oh, how idyllic. Anyway, we're not here to talk about parks and woods and lakes, although that would be much more fun than software and data-centric. And look, tell us a little bit about you and what you do, please, Cheryl.
So I'm a professor of accounting and director of the School of Accounting at the Seidman College of Business at Grand Valley State University, which is located in Grand Rapids, Michigan. And as part of my teaching and research, I learned how to do accounting without debits and credits when I was in my master's program and my doctorate program at Michigan State University from a man named Bill McCarthy, who's a professor there. And then when I went out to work in public accounting, I found out that nobody else knew how to do that. And in fact, they didn't even know how to use spreadsheets and just basic database tools at that time. This was back in the late 1980s, dating myself a little bit, but it was 1988. And so I had to beg a supervisor to let me use a spreadsheet to do a fluctuation analysis instead of writing it all out by hand on a, you know, the, I don't know, 22 columns or something ledger paper. And so I realized then that I needed to go back into academia if I was going to try to push the field of accounting forward. And because at that time, academia, at least where I was ahead of practice. And so I went back and got my PhD and then started teaching other people how to do some of the things that I had learned how to do. And now it seems that a lot of practice has jumped ahead of academia. So now I'm sort of looking at it from the other side going, okay, maybe I need to get back into practice now if I'm going to keep pushing the field forward. And I ended up going to a semantic technology conference where I met Dave McComb from Semantic Arts. He's the president of Semantic Arts. And he has an ontology called GIST. We had in accounting an ontology called the Resources Events Agents Ontology, or REA. And that was what we used to build the models of enterprises that allow us to design a database that we can get the accounting information directly from instead of the traditional bookkeeping with debits and credits and journals and ledgers and accounts. And so when I saw Dave present, I was like, well, that's really similar, and that's intriguing because he wasn't using it for accounting. He was using it for other kinds of business software. And I happened to run into him at the airport after the conference, and I asked him, I said, so in a database for a real company, how many tables should it take? Because I can't fathom it needing more than about 300 tables, maybe 400 for a really big company. If you were going to make it so that you could get all the financial statements, every line item, and still account for all the marketing things you need. And he said, yeah, that's about right. And I said, then why do these ERP systems like SAP and PeopleSoft, why do they have like 12,000 tables? And he said, well, they just designed it differently. And so then a couple years later, I got to invite him to be a speaker at a conference that I was sort of in charge of, not putting together directly, but in charge of the people that were putting it together. I was the president of the Strategic and Emerging Technologies section of the American Accounting Association. And so we brought him in as a speaker for the Transformative Technologies workshop that we put together. And I was, again, very intrigued with the ideas that he was presenting and how similar they were to some of the things that I was teaching my students. And so then in 2019, I had an opportunity to attend a workshop that he puts on called Designing and Building Business Ontologies. And that taught me just enough to know that I needed an even deeper dive. And so I was in the process of applying for a sabbatical with my university. And I called Dave and asked him, can I work on a couple of engagements with Semantic Arts employees so that I can see really what you're doing deeper and do a comparison of that with REA and write a research paper about it? And he said, sure, that'd be great. Well, then the pandemic hit and my sabbatical got postponed to 2021. And by that time he was saying, you know, let's write a book instead. Instead of you working on engagements, let's write a book about data-centric accounting. And we had been tossing around a lot of ideas and how it could work, what he was doing with the accounting stuff I was doing. And so we started working on this book. And it is a very different approach to accounting. So all of you listening to this podcast are probably used to doing accounting with debits and credits and journals and ledgers, and you use the accounting equation assets equals liabilities plus owner's equity, and everything stays in balance. And my students definitely believe that that equation is absolutely necessary and debits and credits are absolutely necessary. And yet, if you go back thousands of years, we didn't always do accounting with debits and credits and journals and ledgers. We used to use tokens and clay pots. We used to use sticks with notches in them to represent receivables, and then you'd notch the other side of the stick when it was paid off. And so those are not integral parts of accounting. They're just the way we've done it for hundreds of years. And it was first published as a chapter in a geometry book, actually, in 1494. And so when the computer came along, we didn't take advantage of the computer's capabilities. Instead, we did what Michael Hammer at Harvard would call paving the cow paths. And so we just did the same thing as we always did before, but faster and more accurately. But we didn't take the opportunity to say, hey, is this really the best way to do accounting? Are we capturing all the data that we need to capture? And the answer is no, we're not. Because accounting comes in halfway through the story. We don't start at the beginning of the economic story. We don't jump in until we're pretty darn sure that that transaction is really going to go all the way through to fruition. And so, for example, in the introductory accounting classes that we teach, we always teach students, okay, if you place a purchase order, what journal entry are you going to make? Well, unless you prepay for that purchase order, you're not going to make a journal entry at all because you haven't affected an asset, a liability, or an owner's equity account yet. If you haven't received the goods and you haven't paid for them, you don't have anything. And yet, isn't it important to know that we have made a commitment to pay for these items that we're going to receive? And, you know, that could be a major purchase, and yet we don't account for it. Same thing if we receive a really big sale order from a customer. If we haven't shipped the goods and we haven't received their payment, we don't make an accounting entry at all. And so with data-centric accounting, we want to start at the beginning of the economic story, and we want to capture the commitments that are made and actually be able to report those commitments on a financial statement. And so we're sort of creating some additional columns, if you will, on an income statement. So we're doing an income statement that is what has already happened and what do we think is going to happen. We get much better predictive value from being able to look at the commitments that we've made, as opposed to just saying, well, what did we do last year this time? It's kind of like if you say, what was the weather last year this time versus looking at the radar for what is coming our way. It just doesn't make sense to do that. And yet we do that because that's what we've always done for the last 500 plus years.
Brilliant. That's a great explanation there. Ontology, what does that mean?
So ontology is the study of meaning in philosophy. And in a business context, it's sort of like a dictionary of all the different, a vocabulary, I guess is a better word, way of saying it. So all of the terms that we actually use in the business and how they fit together. And so we use the ontology to develop conceptual models of the business processes. And then we use those models to actually design the data store. And I had always done it with relational databases because that's what I learned in school. But now it's much more efficient to do it with knowledge graphs and triple stores. And that's where Semantic Arts comes in because they are the experts on that. And so it's been a really good partnership between me and Dave, with his staff bringing that expertise and me bringing the accounting expertise to work together.
Oh, fantastic. And we've got Pavel on watching and probably, knowing Pavel, taking copious notes. Pavel has developed a little software program. Well, it's a brilliant little software program. But this is going to be pulling his hair out now, I'm sure. This is revolutionary. So your students obviously think you're bat crazy. Yeah. But are they looking at you as if you're the heretic or the second coming? You know, this is like, hang on a minute, why are we doing this? So that's quite crackers. Like you say, we've been doing it forever. We've got Sage and Xero and QuickBooks all doing it the old-fashioned way. Is your program sort of like we have that and we kick out Xero, or are we not there yet? What's the implications?
So the ultimate goal would be that we would get rid of programs that are ledger based and journals and debits and credits based. Not that we would necessarily put the companies out of business, but hopefully that they would change the way they're doing their software. Sure. To be more consistent with this. Neither Dave or I expect this to be widely adopted during our lifetimes, because this is revolutionary and typically those kinds of things don't hit for a while. Maybe we'll be surprised. That would be wonderful if we are surprised. He's actually implementing it at his firm at Semantic Arts as a proof of concept to make sure that, you know, then we can show the world, hey, look how well this really works. And then hopefully we'll be able to, at least in our lifetime, implement it at some other companies similar to his. His is a software consulting business. And so any kind of a professional services firm, this would, you know, would be the next place to implement it. But we foresee it being able to be used in all kinds of businesses. We're working on models for manufacturing as well. Really, every company has three overall business processes: buy, sell, and make. And it's just a matter of what variations on those processes and what specific vocabulary to put on them. But every process that is there is some variation of buy, sell, or make. Even financing, you're buying money or the buying the use of money. And consulting would be a form of make. And so once you've modeled it for each of those processes for one kind of company, it's pretty easy to take that and extrapolate it to another kind of company as well.
Yeah, sure. So would a fair analogy be the coming of the motor car? Because, you know, for many, many, I was going to say donkey's years, but for many thousands of years, we were using the horse. And Henry Ford is quoted as saying, if I'd have asked my customers what they wanted, it would have been a faster horse. But you know, obviously we invented that wheel thing and then the internal combustion engine and all the other things that, that followed on. And now we've got the electric car. But back then, when they had the first car, they didn't have freeways or motorways and parking lots and stuff like that. And so we've had to catch up, haven't we? I think we've sorted that now. Well, we haven't, have we? Because there's too many cars on the road. But I guess that, that is where we are. So
next we'll have the flying cars.
Yes. Yeah. So come on then. In layman's term, because I'm not an accountant and I haven't been to university and I haven't done a PhD, how is data-centric accounting different to traditional accounting and bookkeeping systems? And when we say systems, I guess we're talking about Xero and QuickBooks and Sage and the like.
And even SAP and PeopleSoft, even the big ERP software, although they have source systems that capture the kind of data that we're talking about capturing, they're not embedded into the accounting system part of that software. And so it's all very modular with bridges built between it. And data-centric accounting says, let's capture the raw transaction data, and then let's put the algorithms on top of it to produce the accounting information as a view. And so we can use that same raw transaction data to get marketing views out of it, or to get management views out of it, or production scheduling views out of it. So really, it won't be just an accounting system. It will be an enterprise system that can do the accounting as well as everything else that needs to be done. So it's a very different kind of approach. It's very, it's data-centric, as the name implies. And Dave has written several different books, Semantic Business Systems, and then the Software Wasteland was his second book, and then the Data-Centric Revolution was his third book. And that was not data-centric accounting, that was just data-centric in general. And so Software Wasteland, he talked about the fact that for years and years and years, all of the system developers have been application-centric, and they have copied the data over and over and over for each of the different applications. There's a different copy of the data, which makes it very prone to having dysfunctional data. Data redundancy always causes data inconsistencies. And so by having the data be the centric part of it, that's the most important part of the system, and store the data only once and then retrieve it when you need it for whatever different purpose, you keep the data cleaner that way, and you're not going to have all of the issues. And by putting all of the accruals and deferrals on in the algorithm that produces the accounting information, instead of embedding those accruals and deferrals in the data, you make it so that you can use that same data for cost accounting purposes. You're not an accountant, so you might not know that once you make journal entries and you contaminate the data with the accruals and deferrals, then to try to get the information out that you need for cost accounting purposes or managerial accounting purposes, you have to try to back out those accruals and deferrals. You have to kind of transform the data back to what it was, and you never can really know that you got it truly the way it was because you didn't capture it in that format to be able to use it. Well, in this, you won't have to transform it back because it will already be there in its pure form, and you can use that data for the managerial and cost accounting purposes. And still apply the deferrals and accruals as you need them to produce generally accepted accounting principles based financial statements. Every country has a set of GAAP. It's a little different, GAAP UK versus GAAP US, but it's still, there's a lot of overlap between them. And so you want to make sure that you're compliant with those. And so you build that the compliance into the algorithms. And then as the compliance changes, you change your algorithm. And so that's the primary difference, is just, the whole approach of having the data be the most important thing and then putting all the accounting as part of the view.
Brilliant. So Pavel has got a question. I knew he'd come up with a great question.
Okay.
How do you intend to translate your model to finance model needed for getting a bank manager to provide you with operational financing?
For our company or for just a general company?
I'm guessing that he means if so at the moment with my small business, I can get a P&L and a cash flow forecast and I can go to my bank manager and get a loan.
So you'll still be able to produce the same financial statements as you could in a debit credit system. We're just producing them in a different way, but we're still producing the same financial statements that you're used to. We can also generate an additional column for the income statement that will provide better forecasting, but you'll still be able to get your P&L. You'll still be able to get your balance sheet. You'll still be able to generate a statement of cash flows. You'll actually be able to get them for any period of time that you want, which is another benefit of data-centric accounting compared to traditional systems. If you want an income statement just for a day, you'll be able to produce an income statement just for that day. If you want one for a week, you can do a week. If you want it for a month, you can do it for a month. You don't ever have to close the books. They're always closed automatically. And so that's another real savings for data-centric accounting compared to traditional accounting systems, because with traditional accounting systems, we have to make a bunch of closing entries to clear out the accounts that were for a time period so that they have zero balances to start the next time period. But when we keep the data as being the centric part of the system, we can apply whatever algorithms to get whatever dates we want. And so we don't ever have to make closing entries because we're not storing account balances except for resources and for counterparties. And so resources are things that are physical that we can count, things like inventory and fixed assets. Those have balances because their nature is such that they have balances. And counterparties would be vendor accounts and customer accounts. And those have balances of what you owe them or what they owe you. And we're not keeping track just of the financial side, not just what cash do they owe us or we owe them, but also what goods do they owe us or we owe them. And those are really the only accounts that have balances. Everything else is flow accounts. Everything else is activity. And you can capture that activity for whatever time range you want and then figure out what the balances are in those other accounts. And you can get your financial statements that way without having to do a bunch of closing entries that often take days or weeks for companies to do.
Awesome. I hope that answers your question, Pavel. And he's got another one there. He remembers in the early 90s, the 4GL system, and remembers ERP language implemented in 4GL. This is way over my head. Thank you for this, Pavel. However, the implementers need to use ERP language to implement ERP. So his question is, how do you intend to mitigate the 2 to 3 layer complexities?
I'm not familiar with the 4GL. I'm not sure why, because it seems like I would have known about those. This would be a better question for Dave, because he's doing the technical side of this and writing his developers are writing the programs for it. So I guess I don't know the answer to this question.
So I've got a suggestion. Pavel, meet Cheryl. Cheryl, meet Pavel, and connect with each other on LinkedIn afterwards and have a good old chat, because this is absolutely fascinating. So why would you want to change from your traditional to this data-centric accounting? What are the biggest benefits that I would get running my business?
So I think the flexibility is the biggest key. The ability to not have to close your books and to be able to get financial statements for any period of time that you're interested in. It's also better forecasting, because you're also capturing your commitments. And it's interesting, because a lot of people say, well, the reason we don't capture commitments in a traditional accounting system is because they're not certain enough, and we don't want to capture anything that's not certain. Well, yes, we do capture things that are not certain. We record accounts receivable, and then we have to make estimates for how much of it do we think we're not going to be able to collect, and call that net accounts receivable. That's still not certain. So why can we do that, but we can't record sale orders and say that, you know, okay, we have an obligation to ship these goods and a right to receive payment for them, even though neither one of them has happened yet. And so we don't have an asset, a liability, or an equity. It's still an important business event. It's part of a financial business process that is in process. And so why can't we report that just because it's less certain than the account receivable part of it is? Again, it's just a mindset that we've been in for 500 plus years. And so we have to break out of that mindset to try to understand that that actually has good information value. That's better for forecasting than what last year's sales were this month. And so I think the flexibility, the increased forecasting, I think another aspect of flexibility is if we can get this all to work the way we think it will, and we're well on our way to making it happen, you could choose different methods in your reporting. And so, for example, for inventory costing, companies can choose between first in, first out costing, or last in, first out costing, or weighted average unit costing, or specific identification costing. And for fixed assets, they can choose different methods for depreciation, either double declining balance or straight line depreciation or some other methods. And with data-centric accounting, you don't make that choice and then build that into the data. You make that choice on the interface side. And so you're not contaminating the data with your choices, which means you can reapply different algorithms and produce the statements multiple ways if you want to. So again, it's huge flexibility. Now, is it going to take a lot of querying power? Yes, absolutely. And that's where the triple stores and the knowledge graphs come in, because that the querying of those is much faster than querying a relational database, say. And so I know how to do it with relational databases, and I'll admit that scaling is going to be an issue, because, and this may be what Pavel was asking about earlier, that those queries are going to go slow as molasses once you get enough data in the system. But with the triple stores and the knowledge graphs, that gets much faster and less complex. And so I'm relying on Dave, though, to really answer that question well.
Cool. Awesome. Finally, if someone wants to learn about data-centric accounting, what do they do?
So be patient for a couple more months.
Okay.
And then when our book comes out, read that. And then if you're intrigued and want to learn more, then contact Dave and I. And of course, you can contact us before the book comes out too. But for sure, once the book comes out, that will have a lot of the answers to a lot of people's questions. And we expect that to be out probably early in 2024. So probably February-ish. And it will be called The Data-Centric Accounting Revolution. And so be looking for that.
And how does it feel to be part of a revolution?
It's fascinating. It's exciting. It's nerve-wracking.
Yeah. So then I guess you are the expert, aren't you?
I'm one of the experts.
Yeah, absolutely fascinating. That is amazing. Thank you so much for coming on and getting up so early to join the show. I've got one more question for you. But before that, I'm just going to give a shout out to my lovely guest next week, who is the wonderful Amy. She's not sure if she's in Australia, but that's where she's from. And she's going to be telling us all about getting clarity to our busy professionals. And I'll just give a shout out. Next week, I've got my workshops. If anybody wants to join me next week, I will teach you how to do LinkedIn in 15 minutes every single day. So that's a 5-day workshop, just 15 minutes each day. It's great fun and you will learn a lot. Okay, so back to my killer question. I always ask my guests this. When you're at primary school or kindergarten, I don't know what you call, elementary school, do you call it in the States?
Elementary school, yes. Yeah.
So when you're at elementary school, what did you want to be? And it wouldn't have been a data-centric scientist, would it? What did you want to be when you grew up, Cheryl?
Like many young girls, I wanted to be a ballerina. But the body control issue, just the whole concept just kind of eluded me. So then I wanted to be a teacher, but I wouldn't have thought about university teaching or teaching accounting. I would have thought about teaching first grade or something like that. So,
well, you've done it and then some, haven't you? So congratulations. Yes. That's absolutely fantastic. And do you still dance or not?
Only when no one's watching.
Ah, right. Okay. Cheryl, you've been lovely. Thank you for the questions, Pavel. If anyone wants to connect with you, they will all be in the show notes on the podcast and on LinkedIn. So Cheryl, thank you very much indeed. And we will see you all again very soon. Cheerio now. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much for having me.
Here we go. Another podcast in the bag. I've been Ashley Leeds. You've been wonderful. Thank you so much for listening. If you want to hear more, then please subscribe and I will see you again another day. You can find me on LinkedIn if you want to catch up. If you fancy being a guest on one of my shows, I do live shows on LinkedIn twice a week, but I also plan to do some real podcasts where we just do audio and probably record it to go on the YouTube channel. And we can talk about absolutely anything in those. So whatever you want to do, get in touch. And thank you for listening. You get out what you put in. Never gonna lose, never gonna win. Long as you're happy, you're always gonna grin.